All right. Welcome, everybody. Welcome all our Torah Anytime viewers. We will do the final part of self-esteem today, Bezat Hashem. Today, we are going to do everything that we learned, and we are going to make it into practical applications. This, the way that we're going to do it is, number one, is we're going to review a little bit, because we did speak about it, signs that you have low self-esteem. How do you know that you have low self-esteem, low confidence? Next, we're going to go with ways to boost your confidence. Obviously, this is the way according to the Torah. And the final way we're going to do it, how you can boost your self-confidence of your children, of your self-esteem to raise your self-esteem, of your spouse to raise your self-esteem, of your child, a friend, a colleague. So it could be plugged into any one of those. So we will begin. The idea behind this one is the first two classes on self-esteem we gave was more, I guess you could say, theoretical. It was more like ideas about it, the importance of it, how it's an obligation that a person has to have that. But today we're going to go very practical. Do halacha lemaaseh, if we could say that. We do practical stuff. What you can do to change yourself, to make yourself, to raise yourself in the self-esteem. Now, last class, we did a little bit. We spoke about signs of low self-esteem. So I'm going to do a quick review on these signs, and then we'll go on with new things. We spoke about. So I'll give you 11 signs that you could consider. If you have these signs, you could say maybe that you might have low self-esteem, or you could also translate it as low confidence if you want. The idea behind this, though, is I always make this I have to make this announcement beforehand. Just because you have these issues that I may say doesn't necessarily mean that you for sure have low self-esteem. There are many certain circumstances that could come on, bring on these issues, not just low self-esteem by itself. So for number one, we'll go through 11 signs that the person may, be a red flag that you may have a low self-esteem. Number one is if you're always getting seek to be validated by others. You cannot make your own decision. You're always waiting to see, you want to buy a new shoe. You take a picture, you send it to all your friends. Be like, is this nice? Should I get this? And be like, if it's nice, you want it, then get it. Why do you have to worry about everybody else? You know, you don't have to go and say, oh, if it's something that you want somebody else's opinion, by all means. But if you feel like you cannot get it unless they approve it, that means that you need to be validated by somebody else. That means that you don't hold highly of your own self-esteem, of your own ideas and what you think about that shoe or whatever the issue is at hand. And that's number one. Number two is if you feel incapable. Sometimes people feel, they're unable to accomplish. They don't even bother. They don't even start. They just feel it's not happening. So that is another sign of a low self-esteem. Number three, this is a review. This we already spoke about last week. Number three is if you feel unloved. Unfortunately, many people, when somebody likes them, they're like, why does this person like me? Like, what's wrong with him or her that they like me? Because I'm so bad, I'm so, worth nothing, that why do they like me? So they have this feeling of unlovable, if you may. And number four is people that always talk badly about themselves. There's no way I'm going to be able to keep Shabbat. There's no way I'm going to be able to learn Torah. There's no way that I could sit down and I could do, this mitzvah. That when there's a sort of an idea called the self-fulfilling prophecy. If you don't think that you can do it, then guess what? You won't do it. So this is a very big idea, and it's a big idea also in Judaism. In Pirkei Avot, it says, we spoke about Al Tiyeh Rasha Bifnei Atzmecha, which means this translation is you're not allowed to be considered a wicked person in your own eyes. Don't consider yourself bad, because then you're going to self-fulfill it, and you will be bad. Number five is unable to handle failure. And this we spoke about. That's what we ended off last time. Is we spoke about it in depth. All the big famous people that failed, right? We spoke about Dyson. We spoke about we spoke about J.K. Rowling. We spoke about a lot of these famous people that they tried to accomplish and they failed. But what made them successful is that they kept on trying. They didn't stop. Okay. So now we're ready for the new things. We're up to number six. Number six is when somebody feels a lack of motivation. Now, unfortunately, this is a very, very common issue with depression, sadness, low self-esteem, anxiety. All these mental issues is very common nowadays. Some people have it to a lower extent than others, but unfortunately, many people do have that. So one of the things is your lack of motivating. One of the reasons why self-esteem is so important is people don't realize if you have a good self-esteem, you're happy. You're a happier person. So in essence, when we're speaking about self-esteem, we're really speaking about happiness. And everybody wants happiness. Every single person, what they want in life is happiness. So the idea behind, when you're not feeling motivated to do things, then one of the reasons is that you have low self-esteem. You know why you don't feel motivated? Because you're not going to be able to accomplish it. You don't feel that you'll be able to do it. So you don't do it. There are many people, they don't start keeping Shabbat. They don't start learning Gemara. Why? Because they feel, I can't. I'm not going to be able to do it. So they don't, besides, this is sort of a building off the one that we said before, where you negatively talk about yourself. When you do that, then it leads up to being not motivated to do certain things. That is number six. Number seven is where people start blaming other people. Instead of taking responsibility for their own issues, they start blaming somebody else. All right, they accidentally drop a glass, call the wife, and they start screaming at the wife, why'd you put the glass over here? Why is it so close to the table? Instead of taking the responsibility, oh, okay, I did that, they start blaming other people. Number eight is when they have this feeling that it's, you know, you're just feeling like you're unhappy and life is not going anywhere. Like you're sort of stuck in a hole and it's this vicious cycle and you cannot accomplish anything. Number nine is the feeling of hopelessness, depression even. You could even add this to depression. That it, you know, depression is usually one of the final stages. It's like, all right, I'm done. There's nothing I can do. And that's why, you speak to people that are depressed, they're constantly tired, they're fatigued, they're laying in bed and they can't get out of bed, they can't accomplish anything. All results from can be from low self-esteem. And I'm not saying depression is for sure low self-esteem. There's many other issues that could come with it, but a very, very strong factor in it is the low self-esteem. Number 10 is perfectionists. People that are perfectionists. If you know somebody who's a perfectionist, they go through so much struggle in their life. Let's say they're doing photography, right? And they take a picture and they're like, no, lighting is not good over here. It could be a little better. And they'll drive themselves crazy. Like I'm talking about like crazy, like pulling out their hair crazy, that it has to be perfect. And one of the reasons is that they're afraid if they do something, somebody else could do better than them. And if somebody else could do better than them, then they have to, everything has to be exactly to perfection. Now, perfectionist, there are many issues and reasons. It's good to be a perfectionist in a sense, but as long as you keep it in a normal level. Once you go to the crazy, that's when you know that you have some issue in there, and it's possible issue that it is underlining in low self-esteem. This is also where, you know, some people are so afraid to make mistakes. You see this in the dating world. And people are you know, when somebody's gotten hurt by someone they love, so they feel very, very closed and very hard to open up to another. Let's say they're going out with another girl. They feel very hard opening up to her. Or if it's a girl and they feel very hard opening up to the other guy. Why? Because they didn't want to put themselves in that vulnerable position again that they failed and they got hurt last time. So it's a similar idea, you know, where you don't want to go out on a limb and accomplish something because you're afraid that it's not going to come out good and it's going to fail. And one of those reasons, again, is of a low self-esteem. And the last one that we'll speak about, number 11, are people that cannot handle criticism. Criticism is a very, very important aspect in your life. You'll get it whether you want to or not from either your parents or your spouse or your friends. If they're good friends, they'll criticize you. They'll give you a rebuke as long as it's good rebuke. But, people see criticism as an attack on their own personal. It's like, why are you telling me what to do? Says, what do you mean? Let me live my life. Don't start preaching me about Shabbat. Don't start preaching me about kosher. Let me do my life. People that can't handle it and can't accept criticism, they take it as an attack. And what I always say is, think of it as free consultation. You know, you want to come, you go to the dietitian. What are the dietitian? What are you doing wrong and what you should be doing right? Somebody's giving you a criticism. Think of it as free consultation. They're telling you what they're doing wrong without you even asking for it.
Some people don't want to take advice from certain people. Mm-hmm. If another person told them the same thing.
Yeah. This, by the way, what you're saying is so on target because this comes a lot in marriages and relationships. Like if a spouse will tell, let's say a husband is there and his wife is getting dressed and she says, oh, does this look good? And he'll say, yeah, it looks great. And then a friend of hers will walk in and she says, the wife is still unsure about the dress and the shoes. Then the wife's friend walks in. And he says, and she asks her friend, she says, oh, does this look good to me? She's like, oh, that's amazing. Really? Really? You really think so? Okay, I'm going to buy it. You know, I'm going to take it. What just happened? Your husband said it's good, and then your friend, because sometimes when it comes from so close to home, it doesn't mean as much. And the same idea as the criticism. Sometimes if a spouse criticizes another spouse, it's taken much harsher than if somebody else would criticize that spouse. So there is a Gemara in Erechin, page 16b, that says, rebuke a fool and he will hate you. Rebuke a wise person and he will love you. Right? This is based off a pasuk in Mishle, in Proverbs, which says, if you rebuke somebody who is wise, he will love you. You know why? I want to speak about this at one point in time, Bezat Hashem in the future, maybe after Hanukkah, we'll speak about the importance of rebuke. And how do you give rebuke? How do you accept criticism? How do you give criticism? What's the right way? Are you obligated to give criticism? There's a lot of different ideas behind it. But it says in the Torah, a wise person will love rebuke. He says, oh, you're giving me advice on how to be better. Why? What's not to like? They don't take it personally. They rather take it to themselves and how to fix it. Okay, so now, I want to give you 20 different types of ways to improve your self-esteem and your confidence. So this is good for either for yourself being. It is important to be healthy, and you want to be in a spiritual healthy state to be able to serve God. You need to have a good self-esteem. Besides the fact that if you want to be able to, you know, be good at business, be more confident, be more, you know, these things will all help you. Number one is that a person has to be realize that they want to change, they want to increase it. It's like somebody that goes into a gym and he goes and he wants to get stronger, but he wants to build up some muscle, lose some fat. But he goes over there and he's like, you know, he doesn't be like, okay, I'm gonna eat better, I'm gonna focus, I'm gonna ask this question. He's like, whatever, just like, I'll go to the gym, you know, I'll sign up, they'll take my money, and then maybe I'll go once every 6 months. You just do the New Year's and then, you know, somewhere before the summer. So he goes and you know, someone like that is not really going to accomplish a lot. They're not going to change a lot. The number one thing that you want to do, you want to lose weight, you want to do certain things. Number one thing is that you have to be like, okay, I want to lose weight. I want to do it. And you convince yourself, if I may, that you are going to accomplish certain things. You have to be willing. This. That's why you go to like Alcoholic Anonymous. What is the first thing you say? Hi, my name is Joe. I'm an alcoholic. You know, you're admitting your issue. That's the first step of when you want to get better. Besides, we're talking about the negative aspect, but then positive, you want to get better. Say like, hi, my name is this. I want to increase my self-esteem. I want to do it. That's the first step number one. Step number one is wanting to do it. This is across the board and everything. You want to be a successful businessman? Step number one is I want to be, you know, I'm going to become a successful businessman. I'm going to become a better husband, you know, a better father, a better child, a better son. No, so number two is to be connected to God. Connected, you don't realize how much of a high self-esteem and happiness brings to a person when they get connected to God. And I'm not talking to God be like, you know, like, me and you, God. You know, you're my heart. I'm talking about real connection. The real connection where people, you know, oh, yeah, I get this all the time. It's now at this point in my life, it's like comical when I hear this. They'll be like, you know, like, they tell me like, you know, me and God have an understanding. You know, it's like, I serve God, I know it'll be okay my way. I'm like, oh, really? All right. So do you have a new Torah that maybe you wrote and that you could share with us? That your way is all? People think that they have this special relationship with God without actually doing anything. Now, granted, everybody does have a special relationship with God. But the idea is you have to build on that. You have to build. The stronger the relationship that you have with God, the higher and the more self-esteem, the happier that you will be. There was a story by Rabbi Meir of Pramazan. He was an older rabbi, and he was walking up the steep, icy mountain. I said it wrong. No, I said it right. Parmesan. Is that like a cheese or something?
Yeah,
Parmesan. This is Parmesan. I'm for sure pronouncing Parmesan. It wrong. You know why? Now, you know, it's like when you ask somebody to say a certain word and specifically. You know, and specifically, you know, you like you can't say those words. Now you ask me to say it, and when I'm concentrating, I'm looking at it and I don't know. Besides the fact that I'm sleep deprived, but you're looking at this and I'm like, I don't know, you know, it's like trying to say something. Not the cheese. All right, let's put it that way. So it's probably, not the eggplant either, right. So he was walking up the steep mountain and he comes up and you know, he's an older man and he has a bunch of young students walking with him and they're slipping and sliding and they're more all over the place. And he's walking, you know, no slipping, no sliding. So after he gets up there, he didn't even budge once. They go over to him and says, Rabbi, he says, how do you do that? He says, you're so much older. You have a cane. Maybe that actually helped you, but how did you do that? So the rabbi said, you know, when you're connected up above, you don't fall down below, which is very, you know, you think of it as that's a spiritual aspect, but no, it also manifests in a physical life. If you're connected to God, you have a stronger footing in this world. You're stronger. You believe. You're able to do. There's an idea. You know, talking about getting close to God before a person goes to sleep. There is something that a person should do. It's called cheshbon nefesh, which is you basically think about what happened that day. And you're like, okay, what I could do better, what I did pretty good, and compliment yourself on what you did good, what you could change, you know, sort of like, you know, going through your mind of what is going on that day. Now, when you're able to do that, you're able to attack things that you need to fix and work and create a better, you know, environment or whatever it is that you need to improve on. When people say this, be like, no, it's too difficult. You know, I even tell people, take a piece of paper, write down what you want to improve. Write it down. Right? Don't show it to your wife, right? Because she's going to frame it and be like, aha, I told you need to fix this. But you do something. It's so important to put it on paper. I tell this all the time. I tell when people are dating, I tell them like this. I say, when you're dating somebody, and I get this question quite frequently, is how do I know it's the one? How do I know? So the usual advice that I give is, number one, it has to make sense up here in the brain. Does it make sense in the brain? right? Is this make sense, or is it something that's an infatuation, or is it something like, no, you could see yourself living with this person for the rest of your life? That's number one. Number two, you go to the heart. Do you have an emotional connection? And number three is you go for downstairs, which is the attraction. You have to make sure that you're attracted to this person. Now, the way that men generally work is the other way around. You know, from down and up. First the attraction, then the heart, and then the brain at the end. The idea is behind it, if you put everything, and I've told people, I'm like, you're not sure about a girl you're dating or a guy that you're dating. You take a piece of paper, you take a line straight down the middle, all the pros, all the cons. Put it down on paper. It's easier to think when you see it. Obviously, burn that as soon as you finish, because you don't want her finding it one day, all her cons of what you feel about her. But it's an idea of putting into, and people say, who's got the time to start thinking and putting a list? So to them, I say this little cute little story. There was a guy who was a woodcutter, and he was taking an axe and he was chopping wood. And he had so much that he had to cut. And people are saying, you know, he's chopping, but it's making very little damage on the wood. So they go over to him and they see the axe is very dull. They go to him and they say, when was the last time you sharpened your axe? He's like, oh, a long time ago. So they're like, you know, sharpen your axe, it'll be much more productive. He's like, sharpen my axe? You think I have time for that? Look how much trees I have to cut. Do I want to spend a half hour now sharpening my axe? And you can see how foolish that sounds. Because if you sharpen the axe, it'll be sharp. You'll be able to do 10 times more in a short amount of time. The same idea is if you want to fix yourself, but you don't know where to go. You don't know what to fix. The idea is you make a list. Make a list of what you want to do, accomplish. And this is the idea of also, when you're doing that, you're connecting to God. You're saying, okay, I want to become a better person. That's number two. Number three is that when a purpose, this is actually said by Rabbi Avram Tversky, and Dr. Avram Tversky. He mentioned like this. He says, when a person has a purpose in their life, they feel better about themselves. If somebody thinks that they're not doing anything, like imagine some guy's in prison and his job in prison is he's holding on and he has to walk around this wheel. And the wheel is turned to a bunch of different vials and his job is just to turn this wheel around. And he's thinking, you know, this wheel's attached to something else on the other side of the wall. And who knows what I'm doing already? You know, like I'm powering up electricity for a whole village. You know, so he's working 20 years every day, 9 to 5 in prison. He takes this thing and he walks around. And he's exhausted. But, you know, he's thinking, you know, he's doing that. Finally, 20 years, the time comes up and he could get out of prison. And he goes out of prison and he says, you know, it's dying me. I want to see what's the other side of this prison wall. Like, what have I been doing the whole time? And then he goes out and he sees he's been doing absolutely nothing. It's just a wheel. They just did it so he could keep busy and won't drive them crazy. This person will feel 20 years of his life just completely wasted. Besides the fact that he was locked up, but if he would have, even if he was walking around the circle, but if he just thought that, okay, I'm providing electricity, I'm saving, I'm helping, I'm doing something, it already makes you feel better. When a person has a purpose and a feeling in their life, they feel better about themselves. This is what the Torah says in Tehillim. It says in Tehillim, chapter 9, verse 9, it says, "Pekudei Hashem Yisharim Yisam Chelev." The ways you're talking about the mitzvot of Hashem are upright, and it causes the heart to rejoice. You know why? Because when you're doing a mitzvah, you're like, okay, I have a purpose. I'm taking this drink. I'm not just drinking because I'm thirsty. I'm making a bracha. You know, I get up in the morning, I'm praying. I have a purpose. I'm doing something. I'm fixing something. I'm correcting something. So already you're bringing yourself to a purpose in your life. When you bring it to a purpose in your life, you already feel better about yourself. You'll feel happier, and you'll have a higher self-esteem. Number four is emunah. Emunah is so important, is so fundamental in every aspect of your life, that if the greater emunah that you have, besides the fact that you'll feel more confident, you'll have a faith in God. Faith in God. The greater faith in God that you have, you will feel, you know, there's nothing that could hurt you. There's nothing that could harm you. There are people that they're not even embarrassed of doing things for God because their faith in God is so strong. Like, whatever, I don't care. You know, there are certain, I'll give you an example. And I don't know if you could relate that this is exactly for emunah aspect, but I'll give you an example how some people they serve God. There's a guy I know, maybe he'll listen to this class, he'll know who I'm talking about. I'm not going to say his name. Right, a tzaddik, a mamasha tzaddik. And he's a guy, he'll take CDs from like all those famous rabbis, the big popular rabbis for Kibbutz and things like that. He'll go out on the street and actually hand it to them. Listen to this. This is really good. Check out his website. He'll actually, you know, go and do that. How many people you know will walk over to a random stranger? Hey, check out this CD. Let's listen to it. First of all, you think that this guy's a rapper. You know, well, yeah, listen to my album. You know, you're trying to sell something on the street. But this guy, he walks around. And he literally just convinces people to listen. Who knows how much schut this guy has? Unbelievable how he goes. And I'll tell you what, to what extent it was. We were driving together. He was in my car. And we were driving. I was going to give a lecture in a certain place. So he was coming along, brought a bunch of stuff that I was going to give out. And we're at a red light. And he looks over. It's on Ocean Parkway. He looks over and he sees there's somebody, you know, there's a Jewish guy in the next one. So he reaches over to my wheel and he starts honking. I'm like, what are you doing? And he rolls down his window and he starts honking. He's like, shh, you know, and he tells the other guy, roll down your window. So the other guy, you know, rolls down his window. I think he's asking for directions or something. He grabs a CD. He says, you ever heard of this rabbi? He's a great rabbi. Listen to it. While on the Ocean Parkway at a red light, he's doing kiruv for this guy. You know, it's unbelievable. He's not embarrassed. There are so many people, you know, that will be like, oh, come on, I can't, what am I going to go do? You know, yeah. When you have a certain level of the way that you work for God, the way that you do things for God, you know, nothing bothers you. These little things like, come on, you know, I'm making billions of dollars over here, so okay, let him put it over there. Chances are, okay, 50-50, he'll put it in or he'll throw it out. I'll take the chance. So that is number four. Number five is to do the right thing. It is so important. People, I guarantee you, everybody could feel this in themselves. When you do the right thing, you feel better about yourself. You're walking down the street, right? You're walking down the street and you see a bum, this guy, homeless guy, sitting on a cardboard box and collecting money. He has a nice little sign, right? I'm not talking about one of those signs that need money to buy weed or anything like that. Like, I'm talking about somebody who seriously needs money to buy food and, you know, maybe some shelter or whatever that he needs, some extra clothing.
How do you see that difference between the guy who just sitting for no reason and collecting money and real?
So you're asking a good question. First of all, there's an obligation when you're giving charity that you have to know, and you don't just throw your money to some person who could be a fake, a fraud, a phony. But at the same time, if you're giving a quarter, and I don't like that, you know, if you're giving a quarter, don't start investigating and be like, okay, so when was the last time you had a job? Okay, why can't you work? What's your financial? I've heard people came to collect money for them, and you know it's in shul, so you hear somebody and they start asking, so where are you from? So why do you do this? And after like 5 minutes, this guy is already feeling like 2 cents. He's already asking for money, and besides the fact that he's feeling so bad, you're questioning him, like, you know, you're an FBI agent and he's, you know, some foreign, you know, person coming into the country with who knows what. At the end of the day, the guy gave him $1 or $2. I'm like, if you're questioning him, you give him a significant... You know when you question? When you're giving a significant donation. When you're giving something that, you know, it's a lot of money, then you start questioning. I want to know where my money's going to. But if someone's going... I'm not talking about someone's coming to him and he's like, you know, he's like itching, you know, he's like scratching everywhere. Obviously some sort of drug addict. You know, he's like white powder around his nose. It'd be like, I need some more money. And he's just stuttering. Obviously, okay, that guy say, listen, buddy, you know, keep on walking. But if it's some guy that, you know, looks like somebody that they could use the money, you don't have to start... You give a quarter, you don't have to start questioning it. For giving a dollar, you don't have to start questioning that. Besides the fact it's a Kiddush Hashem. You're walking past by the street, there's somebody that's walking, you know, that's collecting money. You give a charity, it's a Kiddush Hashem. It's a tremendous... Be like, oh, look, the Jews give me money. You know, the Jews, even whether it's Jewish or not Jewish. But obviously it's better to give to the Jewish sources. But again, a dollar, a quarter. No need to investigate. No need to, you know, for that, you just give it. But what happens, you're walking, you give a dollar. And, you know, there's some guy... What do you... You know, you feel like, as you walk away, you're like, yeah, I'm a pretty darn good guy. You know, you feel happy about yourself. You're like smiling. You're like, yeah, I'm a good guy. You know, and the guy says, oh, thank you so much for the generous donation. You just feel, you just made yourself feel so much better. And in fact, you know, that dollar was probably worth it, just the feeling that you had. You're like, that's why the Torah says, it says, it's more, the poor man does more for the rich man than the rich man does for the poor man. Because in essence, this is really where we're speaking about this. We're speaking about the next world. A rich guy gives to that guy, he gives $100 to this poor guy. Now this poor guy has to put food on the table. So now he has some food. But what the poor man gave him the opportunity, now he has unlimited zchut in the next world. He did a mitzvah. Tzedakah, it's an unbelievable mitzvah. So he did. So in essence, the poor man, it does more for the rich man than the rich man does for the poor man. But even in this world, we could say that, because you feel good about yourself. You feel good. You walk away, you start feeling good about yourself. You know, he says, you know what? You're like, all right, I'm a pretty good guy. You boosts your self-esteem. So when you do something good, it boosts your self-esteem. And by the way, this should also be when you, let's say you do a mitzvah. You make a bracha. Instead of saying, you know, bracha, you know, something that you swallow the words, you say, you concentrate. When you finish that, you'd be like, you know what, I just, you know, I prayed really well. You know, I came to Minyan for a whole week straight. Feel good about it. Enjoy it. You know, have that self-satisfaction that could push you on and continue doing that good that you have been doing until now. Number six, which is very similar to number five, is helping others. Helping others is an extremely, when somebody's helping other people, they feel better about themselves. Now, even though it's very similar to what we said before, but this could be, you know, even anything from like, you help an old lady cross the street. Now, you just feel good about yourself. give you this idea, this story. There's a person that loved, I'm talking about love, like this was their life, cruises. They just love cruises. Like their life was a cruise. Twice a year, they took off from work, a week, 10 days, whatever it is, for a cruise. So they go and they're going on cruises the whole life, and they're enjoying it, they love it. And they hear about this cruise that's coming up in 2 years. It's a round the world cruise. Something that's unheard of, that this person, you know, is around. It's like a 2 month voyage. It's like this magnificent ship, a brand new ship. Everything is like crazy. And the guy says, I need to do that. I need to get on that ship. But it's very expensive. It's a 2 month cruise and you know that. So he decides that he's not going on a cruise for the next 2 years. And he's saving up all his money to go on this cruise. And he goes and he saves and he's drooling by this cruise. He's going to go to Alaska and then Hawaii. And then he's going to go like the whole world. And he's going to go to China and Greece. He's going everywhere. So he's fantasizing about this, he's drawing up his itineraries, what he's going to do in each place. Then finally, D-Day comes. He comes in, he boards the ship. The ship is the most amazing ship that he's ever seen. And he's walking around and they set sail. They're setting sail for a few hours. They're far ahead from, you know, they're all is water around, the sun is setting. And he decides he's going to take a walk around the ship. He takes a walk by the far, far end of the ship. And, you know, he sees a couple over there with a little baby. And, you know, they're taking pictures of sunset. It was a beautiful sunset. So he goes over and he's sitting next to them and they're, you know, they see another guy. It's just them in that part of the ship. And they tell him, says, do you mind taking a picture of us with the sunset? Yeah, says, sure, not a problem. And he goes and, you know, they set up right by the edge of the ship, and they set up by where the sun is setting. And, you know, the wife is holding the baby, the husband, you know, everyone, you know, the wife has to make their poses. And meanwhile, the baby sees some wire. And he's like playing with the wire. And, you know, you're taking a picture, you're taking another picture. Meanwhile, the baby sees something. And while the mother is focusing on, you know, looking at the camera, the baby grabs something and yanks it. And instead of, you know, pulling it out, he pulled it so hard that he just, like, you know, he fell off. And he tipped right off the top of the ship and fell all the way down. Now, cruise ships are extremely high. You know, I don't know. I'm talking. I probably should have done more research. I usually like doing research. I'm assuming 100 feet is fair to say from the top deck, you know, to the bottom. So you're talking about like 100 and something feet, and everybody froze for a second. Then the wife started screaming. Everybody ran over. You know, it was just this guy and the two parents, and the wife is screaming, and they see the child, you know, hit the water, and by this time the father just faints, passes out. He just passes out from the shock of this. The wife is screaming, somebody help, and you're sitting over there. This guy is sitting over there looking over, and he's like, he sees the baby like splashing a little bit with the waves, and then with, you know, it's a baby. After like, you know, 5 seconds, there's no more splashing. And this guy, the woman is going crazy. This guy is thinking, he's like, without thinking, instinct comes in, he jumps overboard. And, you know, I don't know if you've ever done jumping from height. I've done it, you know, single and idiotic, I guess you could call it. In Israel, we jumped off this like cliff. They're talking about maybe 60 or 70 feet. The feeling is, yeah, 60 or 70 feet.
You jump?
Yeah. It was crazy. It was not, it's something that, you know, you jump off, and you know, you're like, it's not so bad, yeah. And then you're like, where's the ground? Like, why is it taking so long? And then, you know, until you actually hit, it's sort of like as you're jumping and falling, it's sort of like time sort of like freezes. And this guy jumps over and he's like, where's the ground? Why am I not hitting it yet? And then suddenly, you know, he's falling. He's not an experienced diver. He falls, and then he feels when he hits the water, because everything is in pain. Yeah, belly flopped at 100 feet. There's a guy with, you know, everything is in pain. He feel like he broke something. It's like, but he gathers all his strength and he swims up to the sea level. And he looks around quickly. And he can't even turn around. His back is in pain. His arm is in pain. He can barely swim. But, you know, the adrenaline for the baby is like rushing to him. He looks around. He doesn't see the baby. He dives under. He left from a clear water place. He was able to see like 10 feet down. There was a baby. He was basically drowning. He was going under the water. He quickly, with every power that he has left him, he goes and he dives down to the baby. He grabs the baby and he brings it back up to the air. And meanwhile, you know, everybody heard the screaming. They brought down this, you know, lifesaver, clip that they basically clipped them on, and they hoisted them back on. He grabs onto this thing. They hoist him back on deck, and they take the baby. Within like maybe, you know, 30 seconds, they had the baby breathing again. They got it very quick. The baby was coughing up some water, but Baruch Hashem, the baby was all right. But meanwhile, this guy is sitting in excruciating pain, and they see like something, you know, the bones were bending, though not the way that they were supposed to be. So they bring him quickly into the infirmary. They had a full set of infirmary on. And, you know, there's a doctor on board and a nurse on board, and they went and they patched this guy up. This guy, they're like, listen, like, you suffered some serious injury. Says, you need to be on some bed rest. And the guy says, okay, what could I do? And he's on bed rest, and the mother comes in every day, and the father comes in, and they thank him, like, you saved our baby's life. He's like, we owe you everything. And he, you know, I was like, ah, come on, don't worry about it, it's nothing. You know? And meanwhile, he's like, oh, those people better buy me something nice. You know, that he comes in, though, a week goes by, and the doctor says, listen, you got to stay. You're not ready to go out again. And this whole time, he's like, listen, I paid for this cruise. When I'm ready, missing a week. Long story short, the entire trip, he was in the infirmary. He couldn't get out for the entire ship. He leaves that. He's like, look at that. All right, what could I do? All right, time goes by. Some years pass by. He goes on more cruises, a different thing. And 30 years pass by. He has like 60 different types of cruises behind him. And somebody comes over to him and says, listen, you love cruises. What was your best vacation ever? You know what he's going to tell him? He says, there's one time I went on a vacation. I went on a 2-month cruise. And I saved a baby's life. And I didn't see one thing. That was my best vacation. He says, that is the best. When I look back on it, he says, that is the best vacation I've ever had. Because I helped somebody else. I've saved somebody else's life. You know what that means? A purpose. That means saving somebody else's life. This is the idea. He says, when you help somebody else, it gives you a purpose. It gives you such a boost of self-esteem. Like, look how much you're worth. You helped somebody. Now, not everybody's able to save other people's life. But if you don't know, you know, by going and giving somebody else a smile, that person could have been depressed. You know how many people are depressed and wanting to kill themselves, and somebody says a kind word to them, and they're like, you know what, life's not that bad. It sounds like, oh, so unlikely. It's more common than you think. So that is number six. Actually, I want to add to this. The idea behind this, this is a very...
true story or what?
This is a story I read. I don't know if it's true or not.
I hope so.
Yeah. So the guy that happened to it, he hopes it was a true story. This is a very famous story. There was once a woman that, this is a true story. There was once a woman that, you know, had her oldest child was very sick. And, you know, she had, unfortunately, you know, the machla, the cancer. And she went and they went on to all these treatments. They tried everything. For years they were fighting it. And, you know, after a certain while, I think she was turning 16 or 17, and, you know, she passed away. She didn't make it. So the whole family took it back. It was a large family. The whole family took it very hard. But the person that took it hardest was the mother. The mother fell into depression. You know, everybody said, you know, you lost a family member. It's hard to bounce back from that. But a year goes by, you know, and life slowly continues. And for this woman, life did not continue. Life stopped when her first daughter died. And the husband says, listen, you know, my dear wife, you know, we both suffered through this. But now the children are suffering also because they don't have a mother now. So they lost a sibling. Why do they need to lose a mother as well? And she's like, how do you even speak to me like that? I lost my child. You don't even know how it feels as a mother. And he says, so basically her life was debilitated from this. She was, you know, she was depressed. She was in bed. She couldn't accomplish anything. And this went on for a few years. And finally, they tried therapy. Nothing was working. Finally, they go, the husband, you know, the wife gets invited to this wedding of somebody who she's very close to. And the husband tells the wife, you're going to the wedding. And the wife tells the husband, no, I'm not. And the husband says, yeah, you are. And then the wife picks up her finger and she says, young man, you know, that's when the guys know to like back down. And says, I am not going to that wedding and you're not going to make me go to the wedding. End of discussion. Right? That's when men usually turn to little puppies. Oh, okay. Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. So he goes but, you know, he just said that. He, you know, the date of the wedding came, didn't mention anything. He asked her, you know, shortly before the wedding began, says, do you mind running across the street and getting something grocery for me? And she says, yeah, sure, not a problem. She goes, she runs out and she comes back with the grocery stuff and she tries to open the door, but it's locked. So she knocks on the door and she's like, somebody locked the door, please open it. And the husband's sitting on the other side, she's like, I'm not opening the door for you. And she's like, have you lost your mind? He's like, what do you mean you're not opening the door for me? Open the door for me right now. He says, I'm not opening the door for you until you go to the wedding. And she says, listen, you must be playing some sick joke, you know, but you're opening this door right now. And the husband says, listen, you know, you could cry, you could scream all you want. I'm not opening the door until you go to the wedding. And she's like, she starts screaming and she starts yelling and says, how dare you do this to me? This is humiliating. How dare you do this to me? And finally, she sees that it's not helping. She says, listen, even if I want to go to the wedding, I can't. I'm not dressed for a wedding. So I need to get dressed for, you know, I need to go in. I got to get my makeup. I got to get my stuff. I figure she's going to try to trick him to get in. And he says, don't worry about it. I thought about that already. It's by the neighbor. She's like, you put my makeup and my dress and my everything by my neighbor? So he says, yeah. He says, how do you know what I want to wear? He says, don't worry about it. I called your mother. She's like, oh, my mother's in on this also. He's like, all right. You know, I was like cracking the knuckles. And she saw that she wasn't getting anywhere, so she went next door. She never saw next door. Her mother was waiting there for her. And, you know, just explained, listen, honey, you know, we're doing this for your benefit. Just please go to the wedding a little bit. It's good to get out and then come back. And she saw she wasn't getting anywhere. She said, fine, you know what? I'll go. I'll entertain you guys. I'll go to the wedding and I'll come back. So she goes, she gets dressed, and she makes her way to the wedding. She goes to the wedding, and they're dancing. They're ready, you know, the wedding already started a while ago. And she's sitting over there, and she's looking around. She says, look at all these happy people. Look how happy they are. And she says, how could they be so happy when there's so much trouble and problems in this world? Don't they know I lost my daughter? How do they even, you know, how people smile? And the more that she was thinking about this, she started just getting very emotional, and she started, you know, feeling the tears coming. So she decided she has to step. She steps outside, and she goes downstairs. And this story happened a few years ago. So for all the young audience, you know, in the olden days, there used to be something called a payphone, where it looks like a little booth that you put in a quarter, and then you can pick up the phone, and then you could, you know, make a call when you didn't have cell phones. So she sees a payphone there with like a little, you know, closed booth. And she's like, okay, let me go over there. I could cry without anybody, you know, like bothering me. She closed the door behind her, you know, which is like one of those doors that you could, you know, without the glass. And she closed the door. She picks up the payphone, and she starts crying. And she starts crying and crying and crying. And meanwhile, in that particular wedding, there was a few, you know, like the poor women that come over there, and they collect money by weddings, you know, to support themselves. So there was an older woman over there. She sees a woman crying. So she walks over to the woman, and she taps her on the back, and she says, you know, like, Madel, what's, you know, is everything okay? And she turns around, and she sees this old woman, and she's like, please don't bother, you know, this crying mother says, please don't bother me. You don't know what I went through. Just leave me alone, please. And she continues crying. And again, this old woman goes and taps her on her shoulder again. And she says, you know, my dear child, tell me what's going on, what's wrong? So she says, she goes over to her, this mother, and says, you'll never understand. You don't understand. And she starts crying to her. She says, I lost my child. She says, do you know what that feels like? She says, you cannot comprehend what I'm going through right now. Please leave me alone. I need to cry. And then she starts venting. She says, I don't understand why people say I can't cry. I need to cry. Let me cry. Please just leave me alone. Let me cry. So this woman, you know, looks at her, and she says, who told you not to cry? And she says, first of all, says, you know, this old woman goes to this mother, and she says, I lost 10 children in the Holocaust. So if anybody knows what you're feeling, I know what you're feeling. So all of a sudden, this woman started listening. She's like, all right, so, you know, maybe I was wrong about this. And this older woman goes and tells her, says, people that tell you not to cry, they're wrong. She says, well, I don't understand why you should cry. Cry. Tears are great. Cry. But don't waste those tears. She says, use those tears. Go start and say tirim. Say, pray for somebody that maybe is sick. Maybe there's another 16-year-old girl out there that's very sick, and her mother doesn't want her to die yet, just like you didn't want your daughter to die. Pray for that girl. Pray for somebody who needs panasa. Pray for somebody who needs a shiduch. Pray for somebody who needs a ufwa shlema. Pray. Just don't waste those tears on nothing. Don't waste them. Pray for something. And she goes and she says, you know what? Fine. She happened to know a few people that were sick, a few people that were, you know, going under certain things. They need panasa, zivu. And she starts crying again. And this time she starts crying. She says a small tehillim. And then she starts crying to God. She says, God, please help this person become better. Help this person have panasa. Help this person have shalom bayit. Help this. And she goes through her entire list. And she's crying for like 15 minutes until she's like cried out. Then she stops crying. And for the first time since her daughter died, she has a feeling after she cried, she never felt better. She just felt like she just out of tears and she just drained out. For the first time, she's like, she actually felt good about herself. She's like, all right, you know, she wipes away her tears and she goes back up to the dance floor. And she went, and then she saw all those people, and all of a sudden a smile came onto her face. And she danced that night like she's never danced before. She's like, she had this certain feeling like, I did something. You know, I helped something. And that changed her from her depression to her out. It's so important how you come to certain situations in life. And I always tell this, you know, girls in particular are usually the emotional ones. And I'm like, you have such power with those tears. Don't waste those tears. And I tell them, I'm like, you know how many tears are wasted on stupid Disney movies? You know, you could show a girl, forget about it. If a girl is pregnant, oh, then forget about it. They'll just see an old man and woman on the subway holding hands. They're in tears already. Look, that's so sweet. Oh, my God. You know, there's another guy buying a rose, and they're just in tears. They see a chocolate that they like that fell on the floor. They're in tears. They just cry for anything, right? Which you think about it, it's such a beautiful thing. Don't waste those tears. Go sit in a Disney movie and watching, you know, some Cinderella, you know, not meeting her man, and then you start crying. Don't waste it on that. Stop watching. Go run to the tehillim. Say some tehillim. Use those tears for a purpose. Pray for somebody that needs a shidduch. Pray for somebody who needs something. It is so powerful, those tears, that you could accomplish almost anything. And this is the idea. When you do good for other people, you start feeling good about yourself. You start feeling not only good about yourself, you're boosting your self-esteem, your self-image, your confidence. Everything changes about you. So you do for others, you're enhanced really doing for yourself. It reminds me, I was speaking about payphone. So, there was once a time I was in Manhattan, and it was running late. I couldn't find a minyan for mincha, and I had to pray. Now, you're in Manhattan, you can't just, you know, take three steps back and, you know, like, and go, you know, make believe like you're praying that, you know, do this, and, you know, people think, well, you're hitting, you know, they're going to call the cops. So I saw a payphone over there. So I actually went and I actually used this trick. I actually went, I picked up, you know, and I made a direct call to God. You know, I prayed mincha. I had to pray mincha over there. I couldn't find the minyan at that point. I was stuck. And, you know, so it actually comes into to handy, those payphones.
Yeah, answer me right away,
yeah? Yeah, direct call, free. Yeah, it's free. Collect call. Yeah. So that's number six. Number seven. Number seven is to be kinder towards other people. When you're kinder towards other people, you'll be kinder, in fact, to yourself as well. Number eight, this is, I'll tell you this off a story from the Gemara. There's a Gemara in Sanhedrin, page 101a. That says that there was once Rabbi Eliezer. Rabbi Eliezer fell very sick, and he was bedbound. And his students came to try to cheer him up. So one student came and says, you know, Rabbi, you are greater to us than a father and a mother. A father and mother only brings us into this world, but you brought us into the next world with all your holy Torah teaching. And completely ignored them. That didn't do anything. So another student comes up and says, our master, our rabbi, says, you are greater to us than the sun. The sun only helps people in this world. He says, but you helped us in the next world as well. Nothing. Third student came, says, you know, Rabbi, you're greater than us in rain. Rain only helps in this world, doesn't help, you know, but you help us in the next world. And nothing. Then Rabbi Akiva comes. Rabbi Akiva comes and he says like this, suffering can be precious. All of a sudden the rabbi gets alert. He wakes up and says, come here, my dear child of Akiva. He's like, tell me, what do you mean by that? What Rabbi Akiva was saying, he says, you know, like, this rabbi, Rabbi Lazar, accomplished so much in his life. But you know what? Rabbi Akiva says, when you are able to teach, you taught. But now that you're not able to teach, when you were able to do chesed, you did chesed. When you were able to do things, you did. But now you're not able to do things. So by not being able to do things, you are, in a sense, accomplishing but what you need to accomplish right now. The suffering in itself is your purpose at this point in time. This is your purpose. And he says, that's what I want to hear. That is something, because that is somebody who's a go-getter, doesn't want to feel like they're debilitated and they can't do anything. But you know what? If you realize that by being where you are right now is where you're supposed to be, then you're going to be like, all right, this is not so bad. This is not so bad. I am where I'm supposed to be. It's just the attitude in life. How am I going to accept it? Okay, God sent this, Baruch Hashem, and you're happy about it. This is very true, and it happens to postpartum. You know, there's something called postpartum depression, where after a woman gives birth, she gets depressed, and you know. And what this even adds on to it is the fact you have a woman, right? Her husband leaves for work at 8 o'clock, and let's say he leaves to run some errands, and she's sitting, the house is a mess, and she's feeding the baby and on the couch. He comes back like 6 hours later, or 8 hours later, and the house is exactly the same mess, and she's in exactly the same place, doing exactly the same thing, feeding the baby, and she's very frustrated. She's like, I'm not accomplishing anything. I'm sitting over here, I'm wasting it. What am I doing? And it just brings him down. And a smart husband will say like this, be like, no, you're doing what you're supposed to be doing. You're being mommy, and being mommy is what you need to be right now. And that is what you need to do. And when you realize that you are where you're supposed to be, it's also the fundamentals of emunah. You are where you are, and you're supposed to do what you're supposed to be doing. He says, then you feel better about yourself. This is the idea of the importance of woman. It says in Shemot, chapter 9, 19, verse 3, it says, Koto omar lebet Yaakov v'taged lebnei Israel. Explains the commentators, first, Bet Yaakov is referring to women. Bnei Israel is referring to men. Who does it say first? When God was telling Moshe to tell this, God told Moshe, first tell the woman. It says first the woman and then the men. You know why? Because as the commentators explained this, Mefashim explained this, it says women have they are the foundation of the house. They are the foundation of the house. For the majority of the baby's life, the mother is teaching the child all that he needs to know or she needs to know about Judaism, about halachot, about hashkafa. The mother is there. The mother is the one that's going to do. Says you're so important. You're the next generation. You're the next generation. Then you have to feel good about yourself. How are you going to feel? How are you going to be able to? This is the side of the point that people that are coming from a Baal Teshuva background, they're coming. They want to raise their child in a way of Torah. They have to learn a lot. They have to know all these laws. They have to know all these things, that the customs and the ideas behind the mitzvot of what they need to do. Number nine. People think, you know, what's the point I won't accomplish? We spoke about this before. There was once an experienced rock climber. If you ever, you know, and I'm not talking about rock climbing where you go to like these boulders place, you know, where you have these little nice hood hedges, you're with a string all the way around and you climb on and be like, oh my God, I broke an ankle. I can't believe I just did that. You know, yeah, I'm talking about serious rock climbing where you go up and you're like, that's physically not possible for a human to climb. That's where the rock climbers, they go and they grab on by their like fingernails and they climb up. And somebody asked one of these professional rock climbers, says, how do you do it? How is it that you're able to climb these things? You look up, it's like, there's no way you're going to be able to do it. So he answers, he says, I don't look all the way up to see what I need to get to. I look at where's the next place I'm going to put my finger. Where's the next place I'm going to put my foot. I go one step at a time. He says, but many people in life, they feel like they can't accomplish. He says, don't think about, okay, I'm going to wait, I can't finish the Gemara, so I started. Do one step at a time. Start with one line at a time. Start with one page at a time. Start with one Shabbat at a time. Start with one kosher meal at a time. You start it, and then you go into the next one. And then you go to the next one. Instead of thinking, okay, I'm never going to be able to accomplish that, you do step by step. You'll be able to accomplish much more. Number 10 is... Oh, it's running low. Okay. Number 10 is to complete something. This is a very important when you finish something, even if you take a sefel, in English, just finish it. But cover to cover, you feel better about yourself. You're completing something. This is why there was a famous corporate coach by the name of Stephen Covey. He calls goals are dreams with the deadlines. He makes smart goals. This is why he tells the corporate people, you know, want to become successful. He says you make yourself smart goals. What is a smart goal? S is for specific. It has to be something specific. It can't be like, okay, I'll be something amazing. You have to be a specific goal. M is for measurable. You have to be able to measure it. Be like, okay, I'm going to accomplish this, and I know how I'm going to be able to accomplish it, and I'll be able to measure my accomplishment. A is for attainable, something realistic, something you're able to do, which is also R is for realistic. So it has to be attainable. You have to be able to do that, and you have to be realistically able to accomplish that. And the last thing, T is time-bound. I'm going to give it a certain time when I'm going to accomplish it. That's a SMART goal. It says you want to accomplish, you make yourself these SMART goals. This is why also, you know, speaking on this idea, Hillel says, when a person goes and says regarding learning Torah, he says, you know, when I'll have time, I'll learn Torah. That doesn't work that way. Because maybe you'll never have time, says Hillel. But rather what you're supposed to do is every time, every day, you set yourself a set goal. Set yourself a smart goal. Every day, I'm going to learn for 20 minutes. Regardless, I have a book, I'm going to open the book for 20 minutes. 20 minutes is not a lot of time. You take from 10 p.m. to 10:20 p.m., no one bothers me, I'm in my room, and I'm learning for 20 minutes. You do by hook, you feel better about yourself. So much so that, you know, after a while, I'll be like, okay, this is my time, I got to do my learning, 10 to 20. It makes yourself, it's a goal, it's attainable, it's easy, it's measurable, it's something you'll start feeling better about yourself. 11 is every time that you refrain from doing something, this is what Ali Shar says, every time you feel good about it. Boost your self-esteem with that. You're like, okay, there was a not immodest woman walking, I didn't look at her, feel good about that. Baruch Hashem, I accomplished something. Number 12, which we spoke about this plenty of times, this is in this topic and in all topics, don't compare yourself to others. Stop comparing. When people compare themselves to others, it's just complete, you know, they're for failure. And, it's getting late. Okay, so the idea behind this also, there was, there's a French philosopher, René Descartes. He says, I think, therefore, I am. You ever heard of that? I think, therefore, I am. This is a famous philosophical saying. Someone took a spin on it and put it into Facebook. And he says, I have Facebook friends, therefore, I am. You know, people judge themselves by, like, okay, I have 400 Facebook friends. This guy has 4,000 Facebook friends. I am nothing compared to this person. And they compare themselves to other with idiotic things. This is a line that I love this line. It was said by Rabbi Menachem Mendel of Kutsk. He said like this. Listen to this, you have to concentrate on this line. If I am I because you are you, and you are you because I am I, then I am not I and you are not you. However, if I am I because I am I, and you are you because you are you, then I am indeed I and you are indeed you. You follow that? That's brilliant. Let me explain what that means. It means that like certain people act a certain way because that's the way other people are going to see them. So that's not really what you're really acting. You're acting because you wanted the other person to see you that way. You're not, you know, screaming on top of your lungs because then people think of you as crazy. So you're not really being you. You're being that other person. He says, but if you are being you because you are being you and you don't care about the other person, then you are indeed you. But if you're doing something for the other person, then you're not you. You're somebody else. I thought that's a fascinating thing. Okay, let's wrap this up over here. The number that will go a little bit faster over here. Number 13 is to... Start, think about the blessings that you have in life. Gratitude. Be grateful. When you're grateful, you're like, okay, my life is not in shambles. I have some things to be grateful for. Even the basic stuff. You know, I always said when we spoke about happiness, you have five fingers, say five things you'd be grateful for. And it could be shoes, whatever, a shirt, clothing, you know, roof over the head, a car, whatever it is, the basic stuff even. Number 14 is, this part of 14. Okay, that was the same idea, 13 and 14. So number 15 is one word, exercise. Exercise makes you feel good about yourself. It makes you feel good about yourself. And that's it, just one period, end of story. Number 16 is focus on things that you can change. Don't focus on things that are unchangeable. Oh, how can I stop? I can never change, there's no point. Don't focus on that. Focus on things that you can change. Number 17 is don't stick around people that bring you down. this, you know, first of all, you see this in Torah. Noach did it, Abraham did it, Sarah did it, Yaakov did it. Noach, he had to separate from the degenerate people in his around him. Abraham, after he destroyed his father's idols, he had to go run away to a different, out of his town. He had to also separate from his nephew Lot. And Sarah had to banish her maidservant, Hagar. She had to move it away. Why? Because he was a bad influence on Yitzhak. I'm sorry. And then you have Yaakov, who had to separate from Laban. So this is something very interesting. This is an interesting research. Research shows that if you're in the presence of these nasty people, and we'll finish off in like 5 minutes. If you're in the presence of these nasty people, there's something called T killer cells. These are cells that fight viruses, fight infections, bacterial and viral infections. So research shows that when you're around these people that are very, you know, negative and always bring you down in that sort of aspect, it weakens these T killer cells and it makes you more probable for illnesses, especially autoimmune disease. So besides the fact that you have less self-esteem from these negative people and you have less self-worth, you also have you're physically more capable to get sick because of this. And that's what it says. It's not just words. It's never just words. The person who says sticks and stones may break our words, they're an idiot. I don't know who said it. Sticks and stones will break my words, but words never. You could destroy somebody with words. You could take somebody. People have committed suicide. This is a story. You didn't even think about speaking about this. There's a story that happened this past week, I think it was, or December 1st or something. There was a girl. I don't know if you guys read this in the news. There was a girl who committed suicide from cyberbullying. People started, because she was overweight, so people started, you know, creating fake accounts for her, and they started doing crazy stuff about her, and people started calling her nonstop. She couldn't handle it anymore. Maybe 16, 17, or she was. I think she was in high school. She sends a message to her parents, says, "I can't do it anymore. I'm ending it." And no, not Jewish. And they run to the house. Meanwhile, she's sitting in her living room with a gun pointed at her chest. And the father is there, and he's trying to, like, he's like, "Please, you know, don't do it." And she's like, "I've made up my mind. I've gone too far. I can't do this anymore." And the father says the story. He's crying. He's like, "You know what it means when my daughter tells me to turn around so I don't have to watch this? I felt hopeless. I couldn't do anything." And she went and she killed herself. She shot herself in front of her father, in front of her family. And you know what this happened? From cyberbullying. What cyberbullying is, you're destroying their self-esteem. You're destroying the person's self-esteem and you take them down. You take them down. People don't, words, sticks and stones will break, words will never, this person died because of words. She killed herself because of words. So it actually will be going on this, this idea that I was speaking before on what research is saying. It says pregnant women who live or work with hostile people that bring down their self-esteem, all these things, they tend to have babies that have weakened immune systems, lower iron levels, and a higher incidence of ADHD. Crazy, crazy, crazy. So the idea is move away from these toxic people. Number 18 is very simple, get enough sleep. When you feel that you sleep enough, you have more, it's just easier to handle things in life. Number 19, smile. Number 20 is surround yourself with important people. That is the things of a quote. So now the question is I have another, the question is, do we do it tonight or do we do it next time? Should we do it next time? Okay, so we'll continue with it. It's on boosting the self-esteem of your child. Yeah, it's fine. Okay. Any questions? Chazak baruch.